If you ask me who my God is, on whose name I call, if you ask me who my God is, He's the God of us all, Allah the Merciful. If you ask me what my book is that I hold in my hand, if you ask me what my book is, it's the Holy Quran, the Holy Quran.
Assalamu alaikum and peace. Welcome to this show of Misconceptions. My name is Muhammad Hashmi, your host for today. And today we have Yusuf Estes with us today. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah.
How are you, Sheikh?
Alhamdulillah. How's everything, Muhammad?
Alhamdulillah. We also have the studio audience with us. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Today, inshallah, we'll be touching on groups, many groups in Islam. It seems to be a lot of differences too, a lot of difference of opinion. So where can we start with that, Sheikh?
That is a big subject.
Groups and differences.
I like the way you jump these things out on me. All right. Groups. Well, first of all, let us mention that there are groups within every religion. They divide up into a number of different groups. And we find that this is no exception for Islam. But Islam is telling us about what happens to this subject, what happens to the people who do it, and also what the cure is for it. So I hope, inshallah, in this program we'll be able to discover more about what a group actually is, and if there is a particular group better than another, and how we as Muslims deal with the subject. What I'd like to do, if you agree, that we could begin with the audience and ask them for their input on this. Do we have anybody in the audience who has something about groups?
Sheikh, I would like to ask, what about the groups, the differences between the groups, the obvious differences between the groups?
Okay, obvious differences between groups. Well, something that would be like really obvious would be if a particular group wears certain kinds of clothes or does their hair a certain way or their shoes a certain way, because you could see them coming. Yeah. So, for instance, if everybody's wearing all pink, okay, that's the pink group. And if somebody else is wearing all orange, that's the orange group, and so on. But that isn't really the way it goes. Usually it boils down to beliefs. And this can be a minor problem or a very large problem. The first and foremost thing for the Muslim is to know what our beliefs really are. We have six things that we believe in. These are the pillars or foundation, the fundamentals, if you will, of Islam in belief. The first is to believe in the uniqueness and oneness of Allah, the way He has described Himself on His terms. The second is to believe in His angels. They really exist. They're made from light, and they always do Allah's bidding. They never disobey Allah. The third is to believe in all of the books that were sent by Allah. So we believe in all books that came from Allah in their original form, original language. Then to believe in the messengers of Allah. These are the prophets. Those are the ones who came with the message that God is one, and so on. Then to believe, the fifth pillar here of belief, is to believe in what is called resurrection in English, or qiyam, or standing again, being brought back to life. That's a key belief in Islam, to be brought back as a live human again. And then the sixth belief, to believe that Allah knows everything that's going to happen, and it's all by His divine decree. These six things are the beliefs. Now, if anyone or a group of people deviate from those, they're no longer Muslim. If they deviate on some of the other beliefs that are more general or even specific that don't affect these, then they may still be within the fold of Islam, but could have a different opinion for some reason. And let us take, for instance, a belief that to go to a graveyard and pray at a graveyard. Now, somebody could say, well, that's totally wrong. But somebody else could say, no, we know there's evidence for praying in a graveyard. But how did you pray? And more important, to whom did you pray? Because if the prayer was to other than Allah, then it's not acceptable. That breaks the first belief. However, if they prayed to Allah, But they thought that going to the graveyard was a good place to do it, then this would be a different problem. Because we know that Muslims, when they go to a graveyard, they should remember the grave themselves.
Yeah.
And mention to the believers, we're praying for you, not to you, for you, hoping you'll go to paradise and me too. Something like this is acceptable. So this would give us an example, at least, of the difference of a belief that is not really affecting the main belief. And by the way, we should correct it if we know the answer to the question. Go to them politely and try to help them understand where we do our prayers. Mostly our prayers are done in the masjid, the mosque, for the men, that is. The women get to pray at home and get more reward there, but that's another subject. So let's see if our audience has another question.
We should.
Yes. My question would be, what about the different madhahib, the schools of thought in Islam?
The schools of thought? Oh, yes. Madhab. Oh, madhahib. Yeah, that's the plural of madhab. And this means schools of thought or fiqh. So we make a distinction between something else. We'll be talking about this in other programs. But there is something called the Sharia of Islam, and there is something which is called the fiqh. Sharia is the fundamentals. This cannot change. If somebody has a different idea of Sharia, this or that, then this is going to leave Islam. However, a fiqh question, this could have different opinions on. For instance, and this is a very clear one, and we see it a lot, is when I'm praying and I'm facing the direction of Mecca, can I put my hands here or here or here? As long as they're facing the Qibla and there's some evidence for what they're doing, we don't need to bother them about this. But if he wants to put his hands on his shoulders, or if he wants to put his hands behind his back, something like this, okay, that doesn't work. And that's not an acceptable opinion. That's not a school of thought. That's the lack of thought. So we wouldn't accept that. So this would give us a difference now between what is fiqh question and what is related to aqidah or beliefs.
Okay. So the Sharia is the fundamental, and the fiqh we can debate.
I don't know if I would say it exactly like that, because if you say Sharia is just fundamental, it is fundamental without a doubt, and it can't change. But all the other matters after that are opinions based on evidences. And when we say we debate, I'm not going to debate with a scholar, because that's what they're there for. But scholars debate amongst themselves what is the most solid evidence. Now keep this in mind. In Islam, everything is always based on evidences. Where is your proof? Without that statement, we really don't know, because it could be floating here, floating there, without any control. There's no rudder to your boat until you have what's called dalil, or evidence, proof for what you're saying.
Does that also apply to a weak hadith and a strong hadith?
The hadith is another topic, of course, but hadith means stories. And well, the stories we receive outside of Quran. Quran also has stories. That is also a book having hadith, but they're from Allah. Whereas the stories of Muhammad, peace be upon him, are also called hadith. And then the hadith, or the content of it, which is called in Arabic matan, or the text, is not what we consider to be weak or strong. It is the riwayah, or the chain of narrators, that brings it to us. And this is what scholars may debate about, but not over the text itself. Because there's no sense talking about the content of the box until you know where the box came from.
Yeah.
Well, if we know who manufactured this thing, then we can talk about what's in it. Let's find out first where it came from, if it has any viable evidence in it.
Well, Sheikh, can we talk about the different groups now, different groups in Islam?
Yeah.
Well, can we name them?
Yeah. By name, there are so many that I can't name them all. We used to do that. It's almost like a game. Remember this group, that group, this one, boom, boom. But now it's reached the level where there's no benefit. It is better actually to say, what does Islam teach? And then let the group compare themselves to the basis and basics of Islam and see if they're in total harmony with that. If they are, then this doesn't look like a problem. But if we find a deviation away from the main line,
away from the fundamentals.
Yeah. And this is actually what we're seeing with a lot of the problematic groups that are out here calling to this crazy stuff or calling to something else over here, screaming and hollering, carrying on, and we're the
any
only
examples
right one.
Of the, any examples of that? All the crazy stuff, the stuff you're talking about?
Pick up your newspaper.
Yeah.
It's loaded with crazy stuff. Yeah. And it's all, everybody's saying, this is Islam, the way I learned it, this is Islam. But the only way to know Islam is to go to the original source. The original source for Islam is the Quran, and the explanation for the Quran, which is Muhammad's life. He is the one who is coming with Quran. The Quran means recitation, coming from Allah. Then, along with the recitation, is the explanation. The Quran basically is only about 600 pages, 604, depending on which, you know, calligraphy you use. So that's not a lot. Especially when you consider that this is influencing today more than 1.5 billion people. So how do they understand those 604 pages? Mm-hmm. Well, and by the way, keep in mind that 88% of the 1.5 billion are not Arabs, don't speak Arabic,
not
and the only Arabic they know is from the Quran. So definitely we have to have people who know and understand the explanation of Quran. This is very, very important. And without it, there is going to be chaos. There must be understanding or there's chaos. And this is proven time and again when we look to those who've gotten in trouble, they've done this, they've done so and so, so-called in the name of Islam, when we sit and talk with them. And we've done this. There actually is a rehab place in Saudi Arabia right now for those who have been in terrorism. And they sit there with these guys and talk with them, and they come to find out, even some Arabs, they didn't know what was Islam. Some of them don't even know the proper way to make ablution or wudu for their prayer.
Yeah.
And why? Is because they got motivated, highly motivated.
In the wrong way.
Emotionally stimulated, but without proper knowledge and understanding.
So what does one do when you approach a subject and you're not sure? How do you go about it?
Yeah, that's the logical question to ask next, isn't it? You must go back to the Arabic. There's no option on this subject.
There is no option.
There can't be an option because the Quran says in the Quran that it is a Quran or recitation, the lughat al-arabiyya, the Arabic language. Without that, you don't really know. And what I recommend for all of our viewers and for our audience as well, spend time as much as you can learning the Arabic from those who really have an understanding of the tongue of the Arab, as they say, Lisan Arabiya. It's very important to do that with scholars who understand and can share with us the meaning and how the idioms are used in these teachings.
Okay, sure. Can I just hold you to that? Can you please keep that forward? Because it's really important that we do speak about the Arabic and the importance of it in our deen, inshallah. We're going to go to a quick break now, inshallah. When we return, we're going to touch back on the Arabic and the different groups in Islam.
Amazing stories. In this program, we get to know about people of the past whose stories were mentioned in the Islamic tradition and related by the Prophet, peace be upon him.
That verily us, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we tell you about the best of the stories. We tell you about the best of the stories. When we narrate a story, when we read a story, when we try to benefit from a story, what we are trying to do in reality is to go back through the steps, through the different parts and sections of this story until the story is actually completed and that we can take the actual benefit directly from the story.
Sheikh Lutfi will narrate these stories in his program Amazing Stories.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered one of the lands to come closer, the destination. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered one whole city to come closer, to move closer to this dead person.
Assalamu alaikum and peace. Welcome back to our show, Misconceptions. So, Sheikh Yusuf, we were talking about the Arabic language and how vital and important it is to actually understand everything in Islam in Arabic.
True.
To get the proper understanding. So can you go on about that?
Once we go back to the Arabic language, we're able to break up a lot of misconceptions. Not only for the ones who are not Muslim, but for Muslims themselves. Mm. And what we find today is that many of the Muslims are divided into these various groups. Now, some of these groups actually are highly encouraged to go forward. But some of the groups, they have problems. Mm. And they even fight amongst themselves. So it's important for us to be able to make these distinctions to know what's acceptable and not acceptable. And we begin with the Arabic language.
Make distinctions within the groups, you mean?
To understand what the true Islam is.
Okay.
Yeah. We have what's called the benchmark or al-Furqan. And we measure everything against that.
Okay.
It's the thing that doesn't move. That's the infallibility is the Quran itself. But it's only in Arabic language. I was thinking, too, that we'll give our audience a chance again to participate and pick up maybe a little bit from where we were in the first part of the episode. Do any of you have... Yes, brother.
Yes, I have a question.
Go ahead.
Sheikh, before you mentioned Sharia, are there different Shariats?
Are there different Sharias?
Yes.
That's an interesting question. Different Sharia.
Let me...
Goodness.
That's excellent the way you said it. Let me put it in perspective. The Sharia of Islam is one. It is one. But there are different people claiming that they have the Sharia of Islam. And how you can measure quickly is to know what Islam really teaches. For instance, let us take, for example, the belief things that we mentioned in the first part. We believe in only one God. And he's so unique that we don't even think of him being like anything in the creation. So if somebody said, well, I think God is a man, or was a man and walked on the earth, this would negate whatever else they said after that because it breaks the first belief. We don't accept that God is like anything. And we have in the Quran the Arabiya. Laysa, it said he isn't, like, laysa kamithlihi shay'in wa huwa samiun basir. So if you understand Arabic, it's saying he's not like anything. He is all hearing and all seeing. Now, if somebody said, well, the first part seems to negate the second part. You said he's not like anything, but then you say he's hearing and seeing. Actually, I heard an American say that. But he thought that the first part canceled the second part and vice versa. He also went on to say that it means the Quran is way out of our ability to comprehend it. Now, this is supposed to be a Muslim teacher. But when I heard all this, I went, hold on, let me go to my teacher. Even though I'm sure I'm right, that's not in Islam. You go to your teachers, you go to the really pros and ask them. And they said, okay, first of all, if you notice, it was Allah's names mentioned. It didn't say he's seeing and hearing, as you said. That's English translation. In Arabic, it said, Laysa kamithlihi shay'in, wa huwa samiun basir. Allah is mentioned here as huwa. Okay? So, Laysa, he isn't like anything. He is all hearing and all seeing. That's not like the creation, is it? Nothing in the creation is all seeing or hearing. Another statement in the Quran, وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفْوًا أَحَدٍ. There isn't anything, anywhere, anytime like him. He is Ahad, and that's unique. Ahad is one. There's no doubt that Ahad is one. But it is not the counting one that we use in Arabic, because in Arabic we have different ways to express. Wahed, and from this comes monotheism, Tawheed, from one. But Ahad is a one that no two is coming after. It's so unique, there's not anything going to be like it. So that's how we're going to say for sure, without any doubt in our minds, that God is not like his creation. So when somebody said, God is like, we're going to say, already you got a problem. We're going to stop right there. Don't even say, and he is in, or he's on, or he's this or that. No, you're making too close to getting away from the meaning. So immediately, that negates what they're doing. Okay? This is a serious question. And we could carry it further and look at some of the other things. Suppose somebody said, well, I don't think we'll really come back in the next life. That's the fifth belief that we have, the Yawm al-Qiyamah, to come back in a body. Living, breathing, seeing, walking, moving, sweating, because that sun will be brought back real close that day. We're going to be on the Day of Judgment really afraid, you know. So we'll be there in a body, having emotions, having our brain, everything will be there. Okay? This is a belief in Islam. If somebody said, no, I don't really believe it, I think we'll just be a spirit floating around. Okay, this is not a belief. So that cancels their so-called Sharia that they have. The only Sharia is the Sharia which is mentioned in Quran and the Sunnah of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. It is the fundamentals that cannot change.
So the groups with different Sharia, what's their excuse? Or where do they get it from?
Well, I think you'd have to ask each group their own.
So there are so many different ones.
Let's take another question. Yes, brother.
My question is, what about different groups in fiqh?
Different groups in fiqh. Fiqh is jurisprudence or
jurisprudence.
Schools of thought, various schools of thought. Now, how does this come about? Now, this is where scholars have observed the Quran in Arabic, the teachings of Muhammad in Arabic, and then they have made conclusions on some of the things that are basically obvious or some of the things that are not quite so obvious. It's in the areas that are not quite so obvious where you'll have differences of opinion. Largely depending on how much they knew about how it was explained by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We could take, for instance, the Hanafiya. These are the followers of the teachings of Abu Hanifa. Abu Hanifa was one of the greatest of all the scholars of his time, without doubt. And until this day, we pray for him and ask Allah to accept from him. We say Rahim Allah after his name. Allah have mercy on him because he's so great. At the same time, he negated anybody to turn what he said into its separate religion. He said it clearly, I forbid anybody to take what I'm teaching unless you know from where I got it. This is an accurate saying from him. Other teachers that he knew also said similar things. For instance, a younger teacher, Imam, came to him once. From Medina, came to Basra, to Medina to meet him. Who is this teacher? Now this teacher observed some things and said to him, well, I have a different opinion. And they talked about their different opinions, like where you might put your hands in salah, things like this. But when it came time to pray, the Imam from Medina followed him exactly. Some people asked this Imam afterwards, oh, did you change your mind? He said, no, I follow my Imam. And he was the Imam, the leader. So this is why I did that. Who is this Imam? Imam Malik. Later, Imam Malik is a teacher of Imam Shafi. Later, Imam Shafi is one of the teachers of Ahmad ibn Hanbal. So if somebody said, I'm Hanbali and I don't care about the Shafi people, what are you talking about? That's his teacher. Or if I'm Shafi, I don't care about these Maliki people or the Hanbali people. Well, one is the teacher, one is the student. And no matter how you look at it, these people are not setting up shop across from each other in competition like a used car lot. We're talking about a succession of teachers, each of them trying to go back to the authentic sources and study more because their teachers told them to do that. Go and get more knowledge. Don't take from me if it is contrary to what's in the Quran and the Sunnah. That's what all of them said. So if somebody today has a difference of opinion in the areas of jurisprudence, schools of thought, this is legitimate. There's not a problem with that. But we suggest to find out which is the most convincing to you, the most accurate from Quran and Sunnah, and accept that. This is a suggestion, but whatever you do, you don't argue with other people because all are right, but some are stronger in their opinion. And that's the best way to sum that one up.
Very, very well summed up. Just a personal question. The difference in denominations in the Christian, say the Christian religion, can that be compared to the different groups in Islam? Because I used to walk around saying, well, I'm a Muslim and there's only one Islam. And there's over like something like 900 denominations in Christianity. And I'm saying, well, there has to be a problem there. but I boast Islam is one. Is it the same?
You brought up a very good point. And on the surface, I would have said the same thing when I got into Islam, because yeah. I'm from one of the groups that actually split when I was a boy,
yeah.
hurt my feelings really bad.
It would.
And people that I cared about, my own friends, suddenly turned against us because we were in the wrong Christian group, believe it or not, in the same city.
Yeah. Yeah.
And when we went back to visit the group that we had been a couple years later, they didn't even want to talk to us. It was crazy. Mm. There was actually a group of Christians in the 1930s, I believe, in Chicago, if I'm not making a mistake, that began to argue over whether or not Adam had a belly button. They argued, no, because he didn't have a mother, so he didn't have a belly button. There's no umbilical cord, therefore he didn't have one. The other group said, no, because he's like any human being, he had to have one. So they began this argument to the extent that they split That's their good. Church in two places. Mm. And there were the ones who had the belly button and the ones who don't have the belly button. And it's sad because this is who? The devil himself coming to split people up. Christianity under Christ when he was here was one. But later the people spread it out and made it into these different ideas.
Yeah.
Judaism at the time of Abraham, that was even before Judaism actually, the true teachings of Abraham became so divided up that by the time of Moses, there were already different understandings and teachings. Then Amen. After Moses, the people split again and again and again. Now, are we exclusive from this? And the answer is no.
We're not.
We are not exclusive from it, and you cannot say there's only one version of Islam, because there are many people out here trying to claim these different versions. There are many groups claiming they have Islam. Some even calling themselves with words Islam in it. But when we compare, we have to find out what is the reality. Let us look to what Muhammad, peace be upon him, told us about this. He said, as the Jews and Christians divide into 71 or 72 schisms. Muslims, you will divide into 73. Now this is an Arabic expression, not to be taken literal, but to be understood more than. So Jewish are dividing a lot. 70 means a lot. 71 means like if you said, I told you 101 times to shut the door. That's what you're saying, but not really. This is actually even more. And so the Christians are dividing even more than the Jews, and the Muslims are dividing more than both of them put together. Could be. And the point is, though, there is division. And who is the author of confusion according to the Bible? The devil. Who is your clear enemy according to the Quran itself? The devil. So who is the one that's causing the schisms and dividing up the people into groups? The devil himself. So what we say, Allah said in the Quran, chapter 2, verse 208, O you who believe, enter into Islam, khafatan, perfectly, and don't divide up. This is also in Quran, because this is from the devil himself calling you to these wrong ways.
MashaAllah. Well, we've run out of time, unfortunately, again. Thank you very much, Sheikh Yusuf, again. We have our website, www.whatsislam.com. Is it What's Islam or What is Islam, Sheikh Yusuf?
There's no room for an apostrophe, so we say whatsislam.com.
So it's www.whatsislam.com. Please go to our website and have a look at some more details about groups and anything else to do with Islam, inshallah. Thank you for joining us once again. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
If you ask me who my prophet is, I will say, haven't you heard? His name is Muhammad, a mercy to the worlds, a mercy to the worlds. If you ask me who my enemy is, I will say, don't you know? If you ask me who my enemy is, he's that same old devil, that same old devil.